Okay, hi everyone. So today we continue with the second objective of our course, which is basically information management, which means databases. So we'll continue with the most popular model that is currently used in industry, and later we'll do more NoSQL databases, but the current most popular model is the relational data model. So last time we talked about data models. They are a mathematical way to basically represent data that resides in a database. So this particular way of structuring data called relations was proposed in 1970 by Ted Codd. He basically proposed these expressions because they can be automatically analyzed by a DBMS and transformed into equivalent expressions. And this is important for query optimization because we want to find if similar expressions in databases can be computed more efficiently. Although, to tell you the truth, programmers still need to know how queries are evaluated, so they are written in the first place in the most optimal way. Like, for instance, most optimizers, including for databases very big, like Oracle databases, they only do query optimization up to a level, like basically four steps or four subqueries. So in cases that you have more subqueries in a big complex query, or these queries are generated automatically, it doesn't do the best optimization possible. So relational databases rely on tables, and in relational databases, basically you see in most results for a query or for a database, a table, and the tables have tuples or rows. And the first row is the row of attributes or column headers. So for instance, the relation schema for this specific data, this specific table, it contains attributes ID, name, address, and status. And then you have four different tuples, four different rows in the table. And it's a quite straightforward, intuitive way to see data represented as tables. So a table is basically a set of rows with no duplicates. So it's basically, you don't have the same row in multiple places. Each row describes a different entity. In our example, different student instances. Each column or attribute states a particular fact about each entity. Each column is usually associated with a domain. Like for instance, the ID is an integer. The name is a string, the address is a string, the status is in a set, and the possible values in that domain of status are fresh, sophomore, junior, and senior. So basically you can specify with the data declaration language, description language, a schema that represents that table, that relation. A relation is the mathematical entity corresponding to a table. And basically a relation is a predicate. And for instance, a tuple XYZ is in the relation R if R of XYZ is true. And I assume that most of you know what the predicate is from CSC 215, Foundations of Computer Science. The first chapters that you cover in that class are logic. And you start with propositional logic and then predicate logic. So a relation is a synonym for a predicate, only that we think about relations as being tuples that are members in the relation, and usually they are obtained from the Cartesian product of the domain of X, the domain of Y, and the domain of Z. But this is an equivalent way of thinking to predicates. And in this case, the predicate is true for those values that participate in the same tuple. Now, why relations and tables are intuitive for databases is because they are very simple models and it matches how we think about data. One of the most used applications in industry, no matter where you will get to work, hospitals or financial industry is Excel. In all jobs that I've ever worked in, Excel is the most important application. You have to structure data, to collect data, to distribute it, and it's done through Excel, through spreadsheets. Now, there are many operations that apply to relations, and they are precisely defined. We will define them actually next class when we'll talk about various unary operations like selection over relation. You want to select those rows that satisfy some logical condition. Projection means take all of the attributes and project only on a subset of the attributes. So from the original rows, tuples in the database, you get the same rows but with less attributes. Deleting of certain rows and so on. Also, there are binary operations like natural join, joining two tables on a specific value or on a specific attribute, Cartesian product, that means every row in the first table combined with every row in the second table, you get a product of how many rows you had in the two tables. Union is just union. If you have two tables with the same attributes, exactly the same attributes, then you can create the union of the two. And as I said earlier, one of the advantages and the reasons why relational databases became popular is because you can prove automatically equivalences of expressions using these operations that we will discuss. And this is very important for query optimization because you basically will get different expressions which have the same meaning, but with different time complexities. In most cases, average time complexity is different. Now, when we talk about relational databases, the first thing that we have to define is the schema. So a relation schema is just the headings of that table that you saw before, and applicable constraints, which are integrity constraints. Like for instance, that an attribute has a unique value for all of the rows. That's a primary key for that table. But you can have other types of constraints, like cardinality constraints, that for a certain value, like in a class, you don't have more students enrolled than the size of that class. You can declare that, for instance, CSC 316 does not have more than 150 students. So that's an integrity constraint and is part of the schema. So a schema has multiple parts, the relation name, which is the table name like student or transcripts or teaching, professors, departments, and so on, attributes, names, and their domains, and integrity constraints. And we'll see that integrity constraints can be of multiple types, intra, relational constraints, like for instance, for a certain relation, constraints like a primary key, that a particular attribute in all the tuples is unique. You don't have two students with the same ID. But there are also inter-relational constraints. For instance, a foreign key constraint is an inter-multiple relations constraint that a foreign key must have a corresponding candidate key or primary key in another table. If you are referring from teaching a department, that department must exist in the department table. Also, there are cardinality constraints, like for instance, some attribute, the values must be greater than zero, although the domain can be bigger. So the domains are usually standard domains like integers, but we want IDs to be positive, or we want ages to be positive. There are no negative ages of people. Also, we want to declare if there are any default values for some attributes, like a certain attribute has, let's say, basically the default value for a student is freshman, for the status for the student. Now, a relation consists of its relation schema and the relation instance, which are basically all the tuples belonging to that relation. Talking about schemas, here is an example. This is a schema for a relation student, which has an ID, a name, a status, and an address. you can specify the relation by just enumerating the attributes or by enumerating the attributes and their domain. This is the most common way that you would see it in databases. In this case, we have ID of the type integer, name of the type string, address of the type string, and status is in this enumeration. And it's a string. Now, one thing that you would see is underscore for certain attributes. And the meaning of that is that that's, that attribute is a key. That means that tuples cannot have the same value in that key attribute. And it's an example of an integrity constraint on that relation. A database schema is a set of such relation schemas, basically all the relations defined in a database, and the constraints among the relations, those interrelational constraints that I mentioned, like foreign keys. A relational database is a schema plus the instance, relation instances in our database. Now, talking about a database schema, here is an example that we will carry throughout this lecture today. Basically, we have several tables. We have a student table with an ID key and then several other attributes, a department with a department ID as being the primary key and a name of the department, a professor with, again, with an ID of the type integer, a name and the department ID, a course, which has a course code, which is the key, and department ID, course name and description, teaching, which has in fact two keys, professor ID and course code is one key, and the semester is another key, or actually all three of them are a key in this case. This example in the transcript, a student ID of the type integer, a course of the type string, and the semester, saying that basically a student can only take a course during one semester. You cannot have multiple tuples that the student takes the same course twice in the same semester. A relation instance is a set of tuples, and the order in databases shouldn't matter. Now, that's not quite true in practical sense. In databases, you get the relations in some order when you can query the database, but you can sort those results in any way you want. You can order by name or ID or anything else. So the order is immaterial. There are no duplicates in the result. This is a set-based semantics. All the tuples in the relation have the same structure. They have the same set of attributes. The attributes are named, so the ordering is immaterial. If I give you two students, one has the ID as the first attribute and the name as the second. Second one has the name and then the ID are basically still correct because the attributes are named. We don't care about the order. Again, when we insert into databases, we can specify the values only without the attributes, and then we know that those values are in the order in which those attributes appear in the database. Every attribute will have a value from the attribute's domain. So basically whatever was the attribute's domain. And finally, the arity of the relation is the number of attributes that that relation has. There is also a special value called null, which is commonly referred as the null value or the unknown or undefined, which we use as a placeholder when we don't have a value for that specific attribute for that specific tuple. And may arise because of lack of information or sometimes by design. Like for instance, we want to store all of the persons in a table. We may have maiden name and we know that is only applicable to, in some cases to females, but not to males. So if we have employee table, maiden name could be null for several of the employees. We do not allow null values in certain sensitive places like the primary key, and we'll see it later that what are the issues, because usually primary keys are used as foreign, as the value referenced by foreign keys, and null cannot be used because we would have issues in that case. multiple tuples at deletion can be referring to the same original value. So again, as an example, a relation instance for the student relation that we saw earlier could be this table, in which we basically have four different students and they correspond to several the attributes that we have in the relation schema. Maybe for some of them, we do not know the status. Maybe they are new students, but they are transfer students. Like for instance, this could be a student whose status is null. We don't have a value for it. Now, I talked about integrity constraints earlier. Integrity constraints are basically logical formulas that have to be true for all legal instances of the database. You can think of them as truth invariants in formal programming languages, where you basically have properties that have to be true throughout the program. So in databases, these truth invariants or integrity constraints basically state that every state of the database have to satisfy these constraints. And these constraints can be of two different types. They can be intra-relational, like for instance, primary keys. They state that a certain attribute has to be unique for all of the tuples. They involve a single relation, and there are interrelational, which can be of multiple types. They can be foreign keys, or they may be more complex assertions. Like for instance, the number that we see in one column in one table is the count that we see in another table. Like the number of students enrolled in the class, if we store it, has to be the same with the number of tuples that have that class in the same semester in the enrollment table. All of these constraints basically protect the database from errors, from inconsistencies, and enforce some rules that we know about the enterprise, like for instance, for a university, the number of seats in every class. There are also another way to classify constraints. There are static constraints. Those are the constraints that specify what are valid legal states of the database. And there are dynamic constraints, which limit the number of the sequence. Basically, they limit the sequences of state transitions. Like for instance, we cannot have a raise of an attribute salary by more than 5% in one transaction. So this basically, it's a trigger that says that if somebody tries to increase the salary, maybe a hacker, with more than 5%, then that should be rejected by the database. The static constraints are again of two types. There are syntactical constraints, like for instance, primary keys, all of the values in the column must be unique. They can be syntactically checked that you do not have, when you insert a tuple, you don't have another tuple that has the same value for an attribute. Or there can be semantic constraints, which involves the meaning of attributes. Like for instance, you cannot register for vote for more than 18 credits. Or for instance, for voting, you cannot vote if you don't have, if you're not 18 or older. Before we continue, I basically want us to, I want to show you how to install the database that I'm going to use for examples in this class. And I'm going to use MariaDB. Some of you may have heard of it. It's basically a split from MySQL, which basically happened about 10 years ago when Sun, the company that at the time owned MySQL, was bought by Oracle. And the original developers of MySQL decided to create another version that is not controlled by a company. And it has a lot of advantages to MySQL. Like for instance, one advantage of MariaDB is that by default, it accepts Unicode. So you can basically set easily, you can have tuples that do not basically have non-Latin characters. It's an easy install. It comes with a tool called HideSQL. It's similar to MySQL Workbench, only that all of this is free and actually much faster than MySQL. Okay. So as I said, in this class, we are going to use MariaDB. And the install is extremely easy. You select the database that you want. Automatically, it finds on what machine you are currently trying to run it. And it tells me that you can download it from that server. So now you will basically choose a different server, DigitalOcean. Okay, it worked. So it has a lot of advantages to MySQL, but also to other databases, beside the fact that it's basically free. Meanwhile, I can check the chat. Yes, MongoDB is included, but because I want to cover databases, most of you did not take databases, and databases is a mandatory outcome of this class. It's both stated as the second outcome of this class, databases and querying, and is also part of the course description and one of the topics that is checked by ABET as being a mandatory subject. So I'm going to install it from scratch. You will do the same probably after the lecture today. MySQL server support. So one thing that we will see later today is that different relational databases support different syntaxes and different features in relational databases. So I will install MySQL, MariaDB. Types are different. So basically there are a lot of issues that are different. Okay. So we installed MariaDB. And now on the desktop, I basically, it also installed HideSQL, which is a simple client that we can use for this class to execute queries. And the first thing that I'm going to do, I was actually working on a previous schema before, but it's completely empty at this point. So I will use it for creating our tables. Okay, so let me show you a few queries that I already prepared. So remember that we had those relations that we saw before, create table student creates a table for that student. And if you want to run it, you basically will run it. And now if we refresh, we have a new table for student. And you can actually select all the tuples from that. And we have no tuples at this point. So let's create all of the other databases. We create table professor, create table department. If you want to drop a table that was created before, you would drop the table, everything works fine. Here we have a create course, which in addition to the primary key, it also has a secondary key. So in the courses, you have course code as a primary key, but the department and the course name is also a primary key. It's a candidate key. So there are no two tuples that have the same department and the course name with different IDs. So let's actually select all. Good. Teaching is going to be another table that I'm going to use. Transcript, this is a table on which I also included check constraints. So check constraints are similar to integrity constraints similar to domains. Like for instance, in this case, I'm specifying that the grade must be in one of these grades. The student ID has to be greater than 0 and less than 1 billion. Then I have some insert statements. So I'm creating a student Joe, and I'm creating a professor Paul Fodor, and I'm creating a department computer science, courses CSE 114, which is computer science 1, with the description procedural programming and object oriented, teaching that the professor 1 teaches CSE 114 in the spring of 2020. So I just pasted everything, ran it, and everything went well. So now if I refresh my tables, I basically will see that each one of those tables has basically different tuples in it. So select all from students will basically give me Joe, the student that is in that table. And from professors, it will give me Paul Fodor, because that's the example that I chose there, and so on. Let me also include the value in transcript. Oops. Ah, for the semester is too long. I think I created it too short. Character of 6. So let's say that is only spring 20. Okay, good. So let's continue with the theory, and then we'll basically take more queries in SQL. So this is an example of an integrity constraint. It's a primary key specifying that the attribute ID has to be unique for all the tuples that we have in the data, in the table. So a key constraint, also called a primary candidate key, is a sequence of attributes A1 to AN with at least N equal 1 of a schema S with the following property: that the schema, that the relation instance S of that schema satisfies the key constraint if and only if at most one row in that table instance S can contain a particular set of attributes A1 to AN for the attributes uppercase A1 to AN. And there is a minimality property. No subset of A1 to AN is a key constraint. So for a key constraint to be a key candidate key, the requirement is that I cannot, there is no subset of the attributes that are also a key. We could have a super key, which is basically any superset of attributes that is, that they are a candidate key. For instance, there are tables like for the student that has the ID as the primary key or a candidate key. And there are tables like transcript, which has 3 attributes: the student ID, the course code, and the semester as a candidate key. It is minimal, means that no subset of the key is a key. So for instance, ID and the name is not a key, because just the ID by itself, it's an attribute, it's a key, it's a candidate key. So the ID and the name is basically what is called a super key, is the superset of a key. And here we have several examples. Basically, in the student table, the ID is a key. In the professor, the ID is the key. In teaching, the course code and the semester is a key. So the same course doesn't have multiple offerings in the same semester. In the course, I have 2 keys. So the course code as by itself is a key, and the department ID and the course name is a separate key. So you can have multiple keys, candidate keys, over a table. Then in the transcript, the student ID, the course code, and the semester is a key. So one of the keys is designated as primary key, and any superset that contains a key is called a super key. I see a question in the chat. Wait, what are the restraint of keys? So basically what the requirement for a key is that there is no relation instance that contains multiple rows with the same values for the key. So if you consider, for instance, the ID to be a key, then there are no multiple rows in that, in any possible instance of that table that has the same ID. If you have two attributes like the course name and the semester to be a key, that basically means that there are no multiple rows in that, in any possible relation instance in which those two are the same value. Okay. Every relation has at least one key. If you take one thing that we said about relations is that all the rows are unique. So if you take the entire set of the row, all the attributes, you can consider it to be a key. It's basically the set of all the attributes in the schema is always a super key because we said that this is a set semantics. There are no multiple tuples with the same value. A schema can have also multiple keys. In the course relation, the course code is one key, and the department name and the course name is another key. We can consider that every course has a single lecture. So there are no multiple listings of the same course in the same semester. But in this example, we basically have that a department offers only once CSE or only as one course CSE 114. It will not list on the department website in courses 114 twice. Okay, so I can show you an example. Let's go to the department webpage. I can go here. And if we go to undergraduate programs, CSE courses, every course is only listed once. We don't have double listings of a course. So this would be kind of like what we have about a key, a possible key in the courses relation. That a department can only offer a course name, a single course with the same name. You don't have computer science once listed twice under two different course codes. Okay, referential integrity are foreign keys. So what the meaning of referential integrity is that an item named in one relation refers to a tuple that describes an item in another relation. So for instance, A1 is a foreign key in the relation R1 to the attribute A2 in the relation R2, which is a possible candidate key. So basically foreign keys, they can be also multiple attributes, but this is the simpler case that you have a candidate key that is a single attribute in the relation R2, and you have a foreign key with the attribute A1 in the relation R1, which is a foreign key to that single attribute candidate key in the relation R2. So A1 is a foreign key to the candidate key A2 in R2. Okay. So the attribute A1 is called the foreign key of R1, referring to the attribute A2 in R2. If whenever there is a value of that attribute A1, there is a tuple R2 in A2 with the attribute A2 in which it has the value V. And A2 is a key, a candidate key of R2. This is a special case of a referential integrity. A2 must be a candidate key of R2, like the course code is a key in the course relation, and from the transcript, you are referring the course code. If no rows exist in R2, then you have a violation of the referential integrity. You don't want to have violations. Not all the rows in R2 need to be referenced. Like for instance, there are courses that are not offered and probably weren't offered for a while. They are out of fashion, let's say. So the relationship is not symmetric. It's really all the foreign keys must refer to a course that exists, but it's not the case that all the courses that are listed in the department must be offered eventually. Okay, the value of a foreign key must not be might not be specified. So the department ID for some professor might be null. There are professors that are basically inter-department, like Professor Joe Mitchell. He is in computer science, but also in applied math. Now, in his case, he has a home department, which is applied math. But there are other professors that are in institutes, and they are not assigned any specific department. They are basically professors that sit between departments, like multidisciplinary. Names of attributes in foreign keys and candidate keys need not to be the same. So for instance, in the teaching relation, we had the professor ID, which was a foreign key to the attribute ID in professor. So the professor ID is a foreign key to the attribute ID in professor. So there are different names of the foreign key and the candidate key in the other database. R1 and R2 might not be need not to be distinct. Like for instance, you have an employee database which contains the ID of the employee and the ID of the manager of that employee, but they are stored in the same relation employee. So basically the manager ID in employee is actually a foreign key to the ID attribute of employee. So you have a foreign key, but the foreign key is to the same basically table. You can think of this as nodes in a linked list. For instance, if you took CSE 214, you have a reference to another node of the same type. This is exactly like that. You basically have the manager ID as being an ID in the same table employee. Every manager is also an employee and has a unique role in employee table. Foreign keys might also consist of several columns. So candidate keys can be several columns, like the course ID and the semester is a candidate key in offerings in the department. But basically, if you have a foreign key in another table, you also have to have multiple attributes that are referring to the candidate key formed of multiple attributes. Of course, the corresponding elements like A of I and B of I have to be in the same domain, not necessarily the same name as we saw before. B1 to Bn still has to be a candidate key in the relation R2. And here we have an example in our database. The course code and the semester of transcript refers to the course code and semester of teaching. So here is basically that example. The course code and the semester is a key, a candidate key in teaching. And in transcript, if we have that the student took a course during some semester, that course and that semester together is a reference to the course code and the semester in teaching. Basically, this is a foreign key that is formed out of multiple attributes. Okay. Now, we talked about relational databases, but really the language that we are using today for constructing the relational databases, manipulating relational databases, that means inserting, deleting tuples, and querying relational databases is SQL. SQL is a single language that describes the database and all the operations on the database, including insertion or updates and deletes and querying of the database. One subset that we will discuss about today is the data definition language. This is the language that is used for describing the schema of a relational database. First thing that you need to know about SQL is that it's case insensitive. All of the words that we are going to use, select, from, where, I'm writing them often in all caps. And in fact, in this tool, Heidi, I basically, you can get, you write it in lower caps and automatically it will be upgraded to all caps when you have keywords. It's just that it's a good tool that identifies when you are actually writing SQL commands or keywords or actual databases or IDs. But even the other fields, like for instance, transcript, data, the table names, the attributes are also case insensitive. Now, this is not quite true because there is also a part that is case sensitive, which are when you are actually working with operating system facts, like for instance, a path in the operating system. Now, depending on the sensitivity of your operating system, lowercase or uppercase directory names may be different and may trigger different issues. So names that are not case sensitive in your operating system, like in Windows or Linux, they may be actually case sensitive in other varieties of the operating system. So when we talk about SQL keys, they are case insensitive, but when we are talking about the values of inside tables or even the folders which contain these tables that are basically the database, they may be case sensitive. The subset that I described as the data definition sublanguage contains several statements. An SQL schema can be created with the command create schema, and then you specify what do you want to create, what schema you want to create. It's usually under the control of a single user. Today we'll also talk about authentication, so you can basically create users and then assign different authorizations for these users, like creating schemas. You authorize Joe to work with that schema. Joe now, because he created the schema, can also drop that schema. Now, SQL has different versions, and SQL 92 is currently the most supported version. And this is where we have differences between various vendors of databases. Somebody was asking a question in the chat privately if MariaDB is different than MySQL and Microsoft SQL. And really is that several database vendors support different standards. Like for instance, SQL 92 is the most supported one, although assertions, which is defined in SQL 92, are not supported in most database systems. SQL 1999 supports recursive queries. We will see what that means. It means that you can basically create a transitive closure by looking at all the edges in a table, triggers and some object-oriented features. SQL 2003 included XML, and 2006 included storing XML into in a database, and then also XQuery. SQL 2008 added ordered by and extended it. SQL 2011 introduced time periods. You can change, you can check ranges if a date is in a specific range. In 2016 was added support for JSON. MariaDB supports basically 92, but not many of these. You cannot store JSON, for instance. So how do you declare a table? You can create a table with the create table statement, table name, and then the attributes and their corresponding types. And we'll talk about types in a couple of seconds. Basically, you have real types, integer types, strings like char and varchar, and we'll see the differences that you may assign the space statically, like 20 characters, no matter what is in the tuple, and that will be faster to actually store values and insert values. And then you have varchar, which is a variable string size with at most the number of characters that you have in the parentheses, which occupies less space for shorter strings, but it takes longer to assert them, to insert them in the database. So talking about SQL types, different database vendors deviate from the standard set of types. And if you are going to this W3 Schools website, you will see the standard set of types, but then you will also see that every single database vendor supports other types. So I will go there, and you see here that MySQL supports a certain set of types and a certain set of numeric types. Then SQL Server, Microsoft SQL Server supports a different set of types. So no, even types are not standardized, even within the same company. So SQL Server is developed by Microsoft, and so is Access, and it supports different set of types. Okay, so you should be very careful with what SQL Server you are using, because different SQL Servers have different types. Okay, I will go over the common ones, and I will focus mainly on MariaDB here. Char of n is used for storing character string values of fixed length. The maximum number of characters in MariaDB is 255 characters, is 50% faster than varchar. Varchar is the next type that we'll discuss. It uses memory uses statical memory allocation, meaning that you are allocating that amount of space no matter what. Is good for things of the same size, like for instance signatures. I'm referring to desk signatures, or basically computer signatures which have the same size, keys, zip codes, because they have 5 characters or 8 or 9 characters, phone numbers, because they have a precise length, social security numbers, and so on. So char is very good for storing things of the same size, strings of the same size. Varchar uses variable length encoding. So basically you would have a reference, internally is implemented with a reference, and then you would have different strings stored at different lengths in different objects. The maximum for this data can hold up to, in pre-MySQL 5.0, it was 255 characters, like for char. And since MySQL 5.0.3, it's 65,000 characters per one single cell in the actually shared for the entire row. And MariaDB is basically a spin of MySQL 5.0, so it basically 5.03, so it basically has this larger size for strings, varchar. It's slower than char because you need to create an object at runtime, but it uses dynamical memory allocation. So the advantage is that you have the size that you are actually needing, not a precise size. The numeric types available in SQL are integer, which are basically integer numeric with no decimal point. Precision is 10 digits. Small int, which is precision of 5 digits. Big int, which is a precision of 19 digits, decimal with precision, and basically the real part, meaning the scale, meaning that the decimal of 5 means that you have 3 digits before the decimal and at most 2 digits after the decimal point. Real with an approximate numerical representation using binary. So you have power, positive and negative powers of basically 2, and you represent the real with the best precision that you can have. So for instance, one known thing about real is that you cannot represent precisely 0.1, because if you try to precisely represent it in binary, you would need an infinite number of digits after basically in binary as powers of minus negative number, 2 to the power of negative numbers. I talked more about that in the IEEE representation of real numbers in my CSC 114 class. So if you took CSC 114, probably with me, you would have an idea why real numbers are not precise representations of real numbers in mathematics. Float is basically a real number, but with precision of 16. Dates and times. Let's see, there is a question. Is there a rational number type? Not in MariaDB, from what I know. So MariaDB does not have a rational number type. Dates and times. So date stores month, year, and day values. Like for instance, these dates which are represented in dates. It has a supported range which specifies dates in basically our time range. Time stores also the hour, minute, and second, and they basically support these kind of values. Daytime combines dates with time. All of the dates and time are basically in one standard time zone. So in case that you insert it in a database, it will be inserted as in the current time zone. So you don't have the time zone as part of the representation of the date. You have it as part of the settings of your current database. Blob. Blob is binary large objects. It can store up to 65 megabytes. It basically are for storing images or storing short, very, very short movies. Enumeration allows you to enumerate a possible list of values. Like for instance, I can use an enumeration for the status of a student. Set is similar to enumeration, only that you can set, you can contain up to 64 values as opposed to 65,000, but you can have multiple than more than one choice. So basically internally is represented through a bitmap, because you basically for every one of the 64 choices, you have a bit, and then you can represent on a bit, 64 bits, you can represent, or 8 bytes, you can represent if the element, what elements are from that set as a value on which are not. XML, MySQL, and actually MySQL doesn't support XML. DB2, Oracle, SQL Server support my XML. I haven't actually tried to store XML, or I do not know if MariaDB supports XML. So let me actually test that. Create table. Let's call it test. And I want to represent something as an XML. Does it support that? And as basically I assumed, it doesn't support that. So XML is not a supported type in databases. I did put parentheses here. No, it's not. Let's see if JSON is. JSON is. So you can store in a database JSON fields in MariaDB. Okay, so I told you about primary keys and candidate keys. They can be represented like this in SQL DDL. A primary key can be declared by enumerating all of the attributes that are in that primary key. A secondary candidate key can be represented with unique, and then within parentheses, the key that is that key candidate. In many of my examples, you will see double dashes and then some comment. Those are comments in SQL. So I actually had it in one of the examples, and you probably saw that this is a candidate key and it worked fine. So it is a comment in SQL if you want to leave yourself some notes. So in this case, I want to, one other thing that I didn't include is drop. So if I want to drop a table, I can drop it with the drop command. So I drop the table that I created before and I recreate it, and it contains a comment. Okay. I will add it as a comment here. Okay. Next, null. There are many problems with null. So there are useful uses of null, like for instance, a maiden name attribute only applies for certain rows, but not all rows or the tuples. The solution is that you put a null is really for a placeholder. The problem with null is that sometimes when you insert the row, you may not know the value, but later you want to update that value, which it requires you to basically delete that tuple and insert it again. It's also not a value of any domain. It's an absence of the value. It's not a value itself. It's not allowed as a primary key or columns constrained by primary keys. You cannot, or constrained by not null. You cannot have them as null values. By default, nulls are accepted. So for instance, in this case, I'm saying that the name cannot be null. So net null basically means that it's not a possible value. Default is the default value if a value is not present when we insert values in the database. So inserting into the database, I will show it to you later, is basically when you insert a tuple in the database. And there are two different syntaxes. You can insert and specify the attributes that you want to specify as values, or you can insert and only specify the values, in which case the order in which the attributes appeared when you created a table should be the same order for the attributes that are passed as values. So the semantic constraints in SQL are primary keys and foreign keys. There are also other semantic constraints, like for instance, the number of students registered in some table is less than the maximum enrollment. And they can be specified in two different ways. They can be specified with check constraints, and that's the constraints that you saw in one of my table, specifying simple check constraints that the grade must be in this set, the student ID has to be within these values, and then every value that will be, every row that will be inserted in this table must have these properties, okay? And this is accepted in MariaDB. So it's no problem if we insert this in MariaDB. So again, we have to drop the table before we create a new table with the same name. So I will drop transcript. And then I create it again and it has no problems. So check constraints are accepted by MariaDB. Also, you can have semantic constraints. So for instance, that the manager's salary is always greater than an employee's salary. So you can basically state that you relate attributes in different columns in this check constraint, in two different columns, but in the same row. Or you can have basically check constraints between multiple rows. And I will basically show you another example of an assertion. Assertion is actually a type of statement that are rarely accepted in databases. Even my Oracle does not currently have it in its database. Unlike check constraints, they are basically constraints over the entire schema. They are usually used for interrelational constraints in databases. So this is an example. I want to say that the number, the zero is less than the number of employees that I have in the database employees. The employee table cannot be empty. If at any time the specifying the constraint, the employee relation is empty, then SQL will basically states a new constraint is defined and this database state will be rejected. My MariaDB doesn't support assertions, so I will not actually ask any questions from assertions. Many databases do not, so it is basically a feature that was defined in SQL 92, but is not actually in use. This is a bigger constraint that uses multiple tables, and actually what it does, it checks an employee with a manager. This is a query that we'll learn next class, a select statement, in which I'm checking that the employee salary is greater than the manager salary, and this is not the case. So there cannot be employees that earn more than their own managers. But assertions are again not supported in MariaDB or MySQL. Domains. You can create either domains with a check constraint or you can create a new domain with the create domain declaration. So again, if you want to create a domain, this is the way to do it. Create domain grades car one, check if the value is in A to F. This, the grades can be between A and F. And then you would use that the grade is in the grades table. Again, MariaDB doesn't support domains. Foreign key constraints is a common feature for any database. So basically in the teaching table, I have two foreign keys. I have a foreign key to for the course code to the course code in courses. And I have another foreign key that the professor ID references the ID attribute in professor. The course table must have a course code attribute and key as a possible candidate key. And in MariaDB, you must specify. So in some databases, database systems, you can ignore the attribute if it has the same name with the attribute that you are referring. In MariaDB, you always have to specify the attribute, even if it's the same name. So I will show you an example. If I delete this teaching table, okay, and I create this table with the same constraint, it works. In some databases, like in Oracle, I can ignore here the attribute when the same attribute name is also present in that other table. But this will basically have an error because it's expecting that the foreign key is there. So it's missing basically the foreign key when we are specifying that what is referencing is the course code in the course table. So you always have to specify what candidate key, even if it's the same name. And then it will work. Okay, this should be working. Yeah, this will be working. Actually, I don't need to drop anymore because it's already dropped from the previous statement. That was the problem that fail at drop, not at create a teaching table. Okay. Okay, one thing that you have to be aware of and careful when you have foreign keys is what do you do when you have circularity between keys? So one table refers to another table, but another attribute in the second table refers to the first table. It's kind of like a chicken and egg problem. Which is the first? Which table will you declare first if that other table doesn't exist yet? And really the solution for that is that you can alter tables by adding the constraints that were missing before. So another thing that you can actually create is a name for that constraint that you want to create. So even in my example here, I can give names to these constraints. Like for instance, drop the table teaching. And this is the constraint, let's say C1. And the other one is the second constraint. And I can basically refer to them, C2. And again, this will not have any problems. I created a table with two constraints. I can add additional constraints with alter table. So that basically I specify on which table and then I can add additional constraints like an additional foreign key, or I can add a column and so on. Okay. The second problem is insertion of rows because you again have, you need the prior existence of a previous row. So if you have a circular constraint, what you basically have to do is to specify that this reference is deferred until you basically have to what you'd want to defer it to. So the foreign key is kind of like a lazy foreign key. It's only applied when you actually need it. It's deferring to when the transaction is actually over. So a transaction may contain multiple inserts And even if the state is inconsistent because there is a foreign key to a tuple that doesn't exist yet, it will have at the end of the transaction. So immediate means that the checking is done immediately, and deferred, which actually is the default for transactions, is that the check will be done only when the transaction commits at the end of the transaction. Reactive constraints. When a constraint is violated, what happens? Typically, the transaction aborts. That means that if a foreign key constraint is violated, that means that we don't have the value in as a candidate key, it basically backtracks. It would be nice to have a mechanism that allows a user to specify how to react in the case of a foreign key violation. Like, for instance, I want to delete a row in a table that has a candidate key that is referred from another table. What would you do when that row is deleted? So usually you can specify it in two different ways, with triggers, which is something that we will learn later this semester. And the second way is you specify what to do when such a action happens. The default is nothing. Basically reject that deletion. But you can also do other things. You can set the value to null, or you can set to some other default value. You change the value of the foreign key, or you cascade delete. So you delete the row that is referenced from one table. It will also delete the row that was referencing to that row, to that candidate key, from the tables that are referencing to it. And then you basically have that in a cascade, because if a row is deleted from a table and that deletes another row from another table and that deletes another row from another table, you have a cascade of deletes. So it applies on all of the deletes that happened on any one of the following up tables. So you specify that with basically these trigger actions that, let's say that we delete a row in teaching, what should happen to the professor IDs? And in this case, we specify no action. But if we modify the professor ID in teaching, it cascades to modify the professor ID in the professor table. And you can specify for different foreign keys, different actions. So the course code on deletion is no action, which basically means that you can't delete the row from this table. You can delete it, but it will not delete or do anything with the course table. Or if you update, it will cascade the effect to the course table. So there are different ways to handle key violations, and that can be done in a cascading way, which is basically this example. Now, how do we do updates? So the data manipulation language is another part of SQL. And inserting a row in a table is done with insert into student, and then you specify the attributes that you want to insert. A second way to do this is not to specify the attributes, but actually enumerate the values into the same order that they were in the original table when it was created. So insert into students, and then you specify the values that get inserted. Either one of these will work in MariaDB. So let me actually show you an example. I think I have the student table created with the same values. MariaDB is here, and I basically insert one student, John Smith, into my table. And now select all rows from student, we'll have Joe and of course John Smith, the second row that was added now. Okay, views. So we talked last time about the physical schema, the conceptual schema, and then the external schema. So the external schema are those virtual tables that are created only on demand they are views over the database used by some specific application. And you can create them in MySQL or MariaDB with the create view command. It's basically a different kind of data structure. You don't have anything in the view until you try to select something from that view. So for instance, in this example, I'm creating a view of transcripts, but I do not want everything from transcripts. I want the student ID, the course and the semester. I'm not interested in the grade that the student got. So I can create a view. And I can also select from that view. So I can basically see the tuples that are available in that view. So in this case, I have no tuples in the transcript database, but it created a view. So if I refresh the schema, it will basically show that I have a view, which is the courses taken. So I have all the tables that I created and also the view that I was looking at. If you want to modify the schema, which is a quite often situation that you didn't add the columns that you are interested in, like for instance, I want the GPA to be a materialized column in my table, I can add that column with a default value in the table student. I can alter the student by adding constraints. I can alter the table by dropping constraints, or I can drop the entire table, as we saw before. So we can modify the schema in any way we want at runtime. Access control. So databases have sensitive information and we want to create multiple users. Users have to be identified and SQL 92 provides create user and grant privileges, two different commands. And I think I already have a user Joe. So I will create another user. Let's call it Paul and with the password and it basically ran that command. And then you can basically grant all privileges to the current schema to the user Joe or to the user Paul. And those users have now access to the current schemas, to all schemas in this case, all the schemas and all the tables within those schemas. Grant access will basically, you can grant update access, selection access. You can grant any kind of access on any view that you want to any user that you want. Like in this case, I'm granting select actions to courses taken to Joe. You can also revoke those grant options. The grant references permissions on a table is needed to create a foreign key. So sometimes you grant references for Joe, for a user to create tables that have foreign keys to other tables, like for instance, foreign keys to the student table. So there is also again an access mode problem. If you grant privileges at the level of the database operation, such as select and update is not adequate. For example, you basically may have access for update, but you also have a path to select objects. Okay. So another way to create not constraints, but something similar to constraints are triggered. So triggered are not in SQL 92, they are in SQL 99. And you can create basically triggers what happens if a certain update happens in a database. So for instance, if somebody wants to update the course code and the semester on a tuple in the transcript database, when the grade is not null, what happens? And in this case, it's a rollback. Now, this statement is not supported in MariaDB. So this is one and the last feature that I cover today that is not supported in MariaDB. Okay. So don't try it, it basically doesn't support it. Next class, we will actually cover SQL statements. So this class we did inserts We didn't do deletes, but you can imagine that deletes are similar to inserts in databases. You can delete a tuple by giving the values for that tuple, okay? Or you can delete all the tuples with a certain value, like the result of a select statement. That's all for today. If you have any questions. Yes, so because we don't have a server on which you can actually host a database, that's why I showed you from scratch how to install MariaDB. You will need to host your own database, and the grading of homework 4 will be done by appointment with a TA. So basically we'll set up a Google form where you basically set a time that out of the all the times for every TA will available, and you will be graded by that TA. So there is no, actually it's a good experience to install and host your own database. Yes, you can use Firebase for the homework, you can use MongoDB, but in the same time for exams, you must know relational databases. As we saw in the previous lecture, most of the databases today are not NoSQL databases, they are relational databases. So we'll cover them first, and then we'll get to NoSQL, MongoDB. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, and see you next class.